Hello everyone. And today I'm going to talk about the response embedded systems. Some of you might already know me. Let's first go with the introduction of the overview. It's a lot, I know. I only have half an hour, so if possible, I would like the questions to. If you have any questions, please ask them at the end of my presentation, because otherwise I won't get to it. So let's first talk a bit about myself. I'm Jamie Cox, as you all probably have figured out by now. I graduated a year ago. Since then I work at Malis, and I've been working in Rust, using Rust actually for the past 4 years. I started working with it because I noticed that it was actually a very good language. It was a very good language. It has some guarantees that no other language can provide, and it has some performance characteristics that are only known to C and C++. On the other hand, well, Rust is a great language, the outside world is not. And as you will see, embedded systems have kind of the tendency to be not that nice in terms of how they interact. So, we have to cut a few corners. We have to make a few sacrifices along the way to make sure that Rust still works on the embedded device. So, the knowledge is provided that is, without warranty of any kind, including but not limited to the warranties of unleashing indescribable horrors that shed you like. Kind of undefined behavior. From this presentation, I use two sources. Might be interesting to look at it yourself. For example, the Rustonomicon, which will explain some things about the inner workings of Rust, which is very important in working on embedded systems. The Embeddedonomicon, which actually tells you how to create an embedded system using Rust. And then some other sources that I used in the meantime. And also one file from Dan's training from last year to be able to boot something on the Nordic board. That file was written in C for one of the exercises I just transformed it into Rust. To start. So, let's first talk about Rust itself. Rust is a programming language. It's a system programming language, which means it has some very interesting characteristics. For example, it has no runtime, no garbage collection. It's supposed to be running on a very low level, even bare metal sometimes. That means you can't really have a runtime or garbage collection. It will also be efficient, because we're running so low level that we have control over basically everything. But on the other hand, we do have a strong type system, which basically makes memory or concurrency-related errors impossible. We'll likely go over that in the next half hour. But if I want to go in depth about how exactly it prevents errors, then we would be here for 2 more hours, so I don't have time for that. My apologies. However, working on embedded systems with Rust is not always a great idea. For example, if you want major tooling, Rust is a very young language. The first release was in 2015. It only existed since 2010. Which was when it was still in the alpha stage. So, if you want something major, I would go for C or C++ and not for Rust. You want to see your environment, same thing. We have a release every 6 weeks. So, the Rust development team is doing its utmost best to keep the breaking changes to a minimum, to have no breaking changes at all. But especially when considering embedded environments which rely on some features that are not yet stable. Stuff might change by accident when you try to upgrade your compiler, and things might go. We'll see an example of that as well. You want to use a right-based language. Most people who graduate college or are starting to look for a new job have had a bit of education in C, C++, Java, Python, but almost never Rust. It doesn't happen today. So if you want people to be able to program in the language that you're using, Rust might not be the best choice. And last but not least, AVR instruction set is not yet supported. There is an experimental compiler which compiles to AVR, but it's not really merged with the mainstream. The other things all work. ARM, RISC-V, MIPS, RPC, even Spark. They all compile fine, but AVR does not. It's unfortunate. This might also change in the future or in a few years when things stabilize a bit and might include it as well. So, with that out of the way, let's talk about our hello world in this. Looks like this, just the main function, then print hello world. It's a bit boring though. It's just main hello world like it's in every language. There's nothing much to say about it, and additionally, a hello world has the annoying tendency to use standard output, which on an embedded system we do not really have. And we'd like to turn all this stuff, the standard input, standard output, standard error, but also the accidental allocation that might happen under the hood. We'd like to turn that all off, and if we try to do that, we get something that looks like this. This is a hello world program that's written in Rust without standard, the standard language. What are the benefits of doing it in such a convoluted and long way? Well, does not only rely on allocations or input output or anything that's basically in the standard library, which includes networking, which includes mutexes, synchronization, atomics. So, for an embedded system, that's actually exactly what we want to have. We don't need all of that. We have just memory map registers, we have input output, we have instructions that do weird stuff. We don't have an allocator, we don't have standard input, standard output, we don't have anything else. So, as an additional benefit, this program will also compile to something that's far leaner. If I remember correctly, 6 kilobytes instead of 188. So, let's go through it step by step. First thing that you notice is those hashtags, which I didn't explain in the last session. Basically, they are compiler directives. Sometimes you need to explain something to the compiler. For example, that we're going to use an unstable item. This is one of those things that happen to be, not stable yet. It might change in the future. So you need to tell your compiler, I'd like to use this. And the compiler says, okay, but might change later. It might break your code when you're navigating the compiler. This also means we have to use an IT compiler. We can't use a stable one because it's not stable. The second part is that we specify no standard library, which is actually the main point of what I'm trying to explain. We can't use standard library, as I said, it contains stuff we don't want, but it also contains stuff that is useful. For example, a main function. If we don't have a main function, we can't start anywhere, and the linker will complain. So, aside from this, we're just going to tell the compiler to link into the CLI key, and then define an external function, printf, which you all know because it's from the standard CLI. And that way the compiler knows, I need to link against libc, and so the linker can actually link against that function here. And stuff will actually compile when I try to compile. That also has an added benefit that libc also contains some information about how to call the main function. The start function is defined in there. Some other magic is defined in there. So, it's always useful. Now, this is the reason why we use a sort feature, to be able to mark a function, to mark a function here as start, which means we tell the compiler we have to link this main function as an entry point in our program. And that function looks like this. We have a function main with argcount, arg value, which is exactly the same, like int main in rp and jack xd, but slightly more annoying, slightly more type level, because it's not something that you're usually doing in Rust. I bet the systems are weird. However, you see that signature, and it's supposed to be that way. You have to declare your main function that way, otherwise your compiler will complain, will say, it's not what I expect. However, if there's someone who decides that maybe an i-slice is too much, because every bash script in existence always returns between 0 and 255, that maybe an 8-bit unsigned integer would be enough, then they can change it, and then this entire program will break, which is why we had this feature need. I'm going to skip that one. Last expression in any function, is the return value. So, if you go back to this function here, you see that it ends in a zero, and then bracket just splits. That's because this last one is an expression, and it's equivalent to just returning zero in C. Not too much to say about that. And then lastly, Rust has something called Panix. Unfortunately, the way we handle Panix at the moment, Panix are handled in Rust, is through something called stack unwinding, which is also being used in C++, and is entirely programmed and defined in the standard library, which we unfortunately don't have, so we have to include our own. The best way to do it is whenever an exception happens, for example, when you try to divide by zero, you just say, jump into the bagging handler, and start an infinite loop, so that programmers can actually break on that. And that's it. Well, it's a lot. It's a lot of information that we need. If I go back, with a simple Hello World program, it's already quite a lot of lines. And if you try to implement this on an x86-64 system, then all these lines are actually necessary, just for Hello World program. However, if you just want to compile something, or for example an ARM system, which I'm going to assume from now on, then this is enough. Just say we don't use the standard library, and define a panic handler. And that's it. You can see the source code there. I put the GitLab repository online so that you can check it yourself. Otherwise, we don't really have a main function here because ARM, especially on embedded systems, uses actually the reset handler for this. And it will kind of use the default reset handler. If you compile this, we get a binary, which you can upload, but it's not really useful because that binary is just an empty file. It's not even defined here, nothing happens, so it's empty. Okay, now that I talked about that, let's talk about why you would actually use Rust, even though it's fairly complicated to use such a program. Well, Rust provides a few guarantees, which I talked about 9 months ago. Namely, for example, no use after free, no double frees, no databases, and no invalid memory read write. As you all know, in C we have some issues with that. We can have pointers to arbitrary memory locations, and if you try to dereference them, you get undefined behavior, and all kinds of shenanigans can happen. In Rust, it's guaranteed not to have those things. So, yeah. It's quite useful actually on an embedded system, because then you can know that you just compile a program and then you already have a few guarantees about whether it will work or not. You don't have to debug on target. Most of the errors that happen in Rust are logic errors, things that you implemented wrongly. For example, when you accidentally add it to a value instead of subtracted, that's a logic error. You can't really help against that. But accidental out of byte writes, when you overflow memory, when you try to write outside an array, this doesn't happen. How does Rust do that without having access to any garbage collection of some sort? Well, Rust verifies a few things at compile time. For example, if you have a reference to an object and you destroy that object, then the reference has to be gone as well. You can't use that reference afterwards because then you'd use a reference to something that's not there anymore. This means that if you try to return a reference from a function, then your compiler will complain. It's also one of the things that occasionally happen in C code, which are really kind of difficult to debug. You can't access an object after destruction anymore. You can't free it twice, because once you free it, it's gone. You can't access it anymore. You can't have shared mutable state. Rust hates shared mutable state. And that's going to be important in the next slide. But for now, if you have two mutable references to the same object, your compiler will complain about that. It's not really nice to do, because then you could move both references to different threads, modify them at the same time, and get great conditions. And lastly, well, no arbitrary memory accesses. Every reference has to exist, every memory write or read basically has to be valid for the compiler not to complain. This also means that Rust will complain about things that are perfectly safe. It's just to prevent you from making mistakes now or in the future. Because it might be that someone else will change your code into something that is not as good, so yeah, don't do it. Now, as you all have noticed, we run into a small, kind of annoying issue here. Namely, hardware is entirely just basically shared mutable state. If we write something to a memory mapped register, we basically write it to a random memory location. And somehow, the Rust compiler does, we want the Rust compiler not to tell us, well, you write into a random memory location. application. This is not right. We know that the memory mapped register. We know that. REST compiler does not. And once you write to it, to that location, everyone ever, well, your entire program will see that modification, and that might cause all possible stuff to go wrong. So, REST does not like that. We want to convince REST to, well, allow it. How do we do that? We use an escape hatch. It's called unsafe code. It's really dangerous too, but for embedded systems, we do need it. Let's talk about unsafe. Sometimes it's very difficult to explain to a compiler that what you're doing is actually, well, that actually works. For example, we say this one is actually a memory location. We can write it there without any issues. It's memory mapped to user. It's fine. Compiler, just trust us. It's fine. Printf won't cause any undefined behavior. It's fine. When you call that, it won't just crash the program, throw a safe vault or anything else, given that we can pass some predefined arguments to it. If we have a matrix and we try to access an element in it, which is smaller than 4, and we know, we verified before, that matrix has more than 4 elements. Why is less than 13 bound checks? We don't know. We don't need them, but it's fine. Double linked lists are really difficult to implement in safe REST because of the structure that they're made of. I can't do an entire explanation about why that is pretty much very dangerous, but I don't have time for that either. Too bad. So, we can't do anything, can't do any of those without actually using an escape hatch. For example, if you want to dereference a random pointer, just define a pointer, and we want to know what's under that location, we have to use an unsafe block to tell us it's okay, we can actually dereference this. If we want to modify static variables, well, we have to use an unsafe block because that static variable might be read in another thread, which means data erases might happen. If you want to call unsafe functions, transmute is a very serious offender in this case. You'll probably never need it and don't trust any code which uses it. Then we can just tell the compiler it's safe. Well, I guarantee you that it's a decent transformation. We can just use the float and reinterpret the bits as an iterator. Transmute is basically reinterpret cast in C++. So, why is it so dangerous? I already explained to you undefined behavior. Any of these three, if used wrongly, if that's not an actual memory location, and it might change from device to device, so doesn't always provide rating. If that's not a real memory location, not a real memory mapped register, then we get undefined behavior. If this is shared, undefined behavior. If this is actually an object that, that cannot have all the states, undefined behavior. Rust doesn't like it. Rust guarantees that we always have defined behavior. And this basically provides us with a way to get around that, so that's not good. So, includes all of those, and it's very easy to get undefined behavior in unsafe Rust, because there are so many more guarantees that actually need to be upheld. There is object safety, bending safety, reference safety, which you see four of them, just the normal things you can see in C. It might well happen, and it occasionally happens that if you have a library which uses a bit of unsafe code, that most of the undefined behavior, basically all of it, comes from there. Most of the bugs, most of the security issues come from that small part of unsafe code that the programmer thought, well, it's okay, and it turned out not to be. As I said before, in safe Rust, we don't have that issue anymore. Everything is guaranteed to work. We can just run, write some safe Rust code, and be guaranteed that everything is defined, that no use of the errors, no undefined behavior will ever occur. That's a very big distinction between safe and unsafe, and is the reason why usually people are not taught about unsafe until very much later when they realize what's actually going on. Let's just put that aside for a while. Let's just assume that unsafe is perfectly free to use. And let's program a bit for an embedded system. This is for STM32F405, the one that you're going to see there. Yes, I'm going to the linked to MicroCube. So you can just define a lot of constants, pointer offsets to memory mapped registers, in this case DPIRC. You can just define functions to read volatilely from that memory location, set a flag, and just write it back, as if you would normally do in C code. Except that in C code, you're using volatile types, while in Rust code, you're using volatile functions. It's not really much to say about that. And then we do some extra compiled magic, compiled directives, to make a function reset, which we implemented ourselves. I aligned that here because it doesn't fit on the slide. And we provide, we provide the compiler with a reset vector, which contains that function, which will be linked in the, using a linked script, will be linked at vector table reset vector, which is the place where RM code expects the starting reset vector to be. So whenever you press the reset button, the code will start again. And it will produce a blinking LED. Now, we just built it. We've got a build with the right target, with the right blinker arcs, which contains also linking scripts and is compiled for thumb, which is a version of ARM. And we can also do that with configuration files, that you don't have to type that every time, but you can just do card build, as you would do with normal projects. And that's it. We made something that compiles and works perfectly on an embedded system. I could stop here. I could just say, everything works. It's fine. You can go try it out. Unfortunately, there's one slight issue with this code. Namely, that we used unsafe code for basically everything. We had so many escape hatches from start to end that we basically threw away all the guarantees that Rust provides us. And just let fate decide whether we have a memory overflow or not. Not really useful when you're actually trying to implement something decent with Rust, because then you're better off with C is safe in that case. So we're going to encapsulate a few things. The basic idea is that if you just backend unsafe behavior inside a few safe functions that you can call, and then everything else in your code can be safe using those functions which are decently verified, and then you still have safe code and you can still do something on an embedded system. For example, you can use modules to your advantage. We, for example, have something that I stole from the standard library, namely a vector. We have a data pointer, a length, and a capacity. And as you all know, vectors assume that the length of the data buffer is equal to the capacity times the size of t. Let's assume that t is 1, then I can just say that the length of the buffer is equal to the capacity. That's a guarantee we have to uphold. If someone decides to set the capacity to 100,000, while we didn't really allocate something, then it might happen that the compiler, that one of the functions tries to increase the buffer size, and thinks, capacity is still okay, and then we write it outside of the buffer, and we get all the undefined behavior that we try to avoid. So what we want to do is guarantee that the capacity is always equal to that length, and we do that by defining a module. The strides are strict in there, allow for some safe functions which always guarantee that the capacity equals length of the buffer. And however we use this vector outside of the module, that guarantee will always be upheld because you cannot breach it from outside. You can only breach it from inside, and we verify that all of that still works. All the entire module that you see there is smaller than a single file. That means all the unsafe code we have to check, the allocation, the freeze, the modification of capacity, all are contained within a single file, which makes it a lot easier to check. You don't accidentally have another file interfering with your safety. You can just keep to this file and write your formal proof. Very much recommended if you're working with unsafe code. Write your proof here. What we are going to do is write more peripherals. We're going to use a mod, module peripherals, which contains all the unsafe code for communicating with the hardware. And then outside of that, all the logic is contained within the same code. which contained within the safe code. Step 2. We still know that hardware is shared mutable state, so even if we have this module with unsafe code, we can still call functions to there, ghost functions with some not as nice capacities. For example, if you call a function there, both outside and inside an interrupt, then it might be that those volatiles reads and writes interfere with each other. In the perfect case of a database, a read causes your hardware not to behave as you want or even outright fail. So, how do we prevent shared mutable state? How do you prevent shared mutable state? Well, we have something in Rust called an ownership system, which basically means, we go back to vector, that this vector owns the data it points to. And if we try to delete this vector, then the data buffer is automatically freed as well. This also means, due to hardware stores, that we only can have one vector structure with the data member pointing to that buffer. If we try to make another one, if we try to clone it, it will either, if we use the function clone, create a new vector with a new data buffer, which is a copy of the previous one, or if you just assign this vector to a new variable, the old variable is invalidated. So we still only have one reference to the buffer, the other one cannot be used anymore. It's part of the ownership system. It's part of what made Rust Rust. So instead of just saying having a function let on, which you can call from anywhere, we create a structure, this sort of interface, and then we use let.on on that let, which mutates let itself, so we never use it from two places at the same time. Now, Rust ownership means that this let object that you created will be unique, and it can only be used at one place. You can still send it to another thread or send it to an interrupt handler, but you cannot clone it, you cannot copy it. And additionally, that's also a feature of Rust, this one takes a mutable reference, uses a mutable reference to the let, which means that if you try to call let on, when you share that between threads, that the compiler will actually complain about it. It will say you have two mutable references to the same object, to the same let, which is not allowed. We're kind of abusing the ownership system here to prevent hardware issues. So, how do we do that? Well, we have a module, we can just hide some code in there, which basically implements a singleton. We can do it just a boolean that checks whether the letter exists or not. And if it exists, then you return null, and otherwise you return a new object which contains the letter. There's only one issue with this code, it's that it's not thread safe because we're using static variables, and as we said, modifying static variables is unsafe because of databases and stuff. How about we make it thread safe? Well, we're working on a better system, we don't really have a mutex. What we do have, shockingly actually, are atomics. Every single compile target for Rust has some support for atomics. Either it is an implementation that just turns off all the interrupts and at the end of the operation turns them on again to make sure that nothing else interrupts your actions. Sometimes, in the case of ARM, there are actual instructions, load exclusive, store exclusive, which will guarantee some very interesting things. But at the forefront, they guarantee that this access is unique, and this combination actually implements an atomic operation, which basically loads from a memory location, stores something else back, and then checks whether some other thread or some interrupt has also accessed the memory location. And in that case, you jump back to the beginning, you load, you store. So this way we have a safe interface with a let structure that we can use. We can just call our let new function. We can call it exactly once, but because the second time it will fail, return a null. And at the end, we have something that works as well. Actually, this is the code that's been loaded up on that device. I did have to check the linker script for whether it would actually compile static variables, because there's some issues with the raw data from case.io, there are a few. Most of these are actually generated from SVD files, which means that they are based on the data, on the documentation, from the vendor itself. The vendor does not really make mistakes. If they do, it just fixes the SVD file and it shares with everyone. So, way less cases of undefined behavior. It's really simplified a lot. They actually use an interrupt-free piece of code to make sure that no two threads are accessing at the same time. I use an atomic. Small difference does not really matter. And lastly, I wanted to add a bonus item. I'm not going to go over appendices. You can do that on your own. Or I will go over them if there's enough requests for that. Just that it will take quite long. Thanks. So Misra, which you all probably know, is the Motor Industry Software Reliability Association. They produce specifications for using C and C++ in a safe context. If you're working on an automotive device, it might be useful to promise to people that it won't just arbitrarily crash or do weird things or steer your car into a ravine. Well, they have a specification. It contains about 200 rules for the 2008 specification. I know that, I went through it 3 times. We also use that at my current employer, so it's fairly straightforward, it's fairly complete, and it contains a lot of rules about, for example, weird variable namings. If you have 2 variable names that are 1 letter apart, and if that 1 letter is an I and an L, then people are going to get confused, use the wrong variable name, and cause crashes. If you handle an ASCII string as a UTF-8 string, or the other way around, you might run into issues as well. Memory management, as usual, C is a very dangerous language for that. Primitive type size mismatches. And lastly, something very interesting, which I only discovered recently, called integer promotion. Everyone gets it. Basically, it says that if you have 2 characters, or 2 shorts, or 2 inside 8-bit integers, and you try to add them together, you get an integer back. Not an 8-bit integer, an integer. For example, we try to compute the average of 2 numbers. We just add them together and divide by 2. It's very simple implementation. It doesn't really sound wrong. If you try that on Linux, on a 32-bit or a 64-bit system, you get, you try to compute the average of 250 and 250, you get back 250. Great, that's what we expect. We can keep on doing it for many systems, for many examples, many tests, a lot of test coverage, and then we think, well, it works. So we upload it to an 8-bit device, which returns 112. Yeah. Reason is that A plus B actually does upcasting, or integer promotion. Instead of being 8 bits inside here, it's 32 bits on a 32-bit system, 16-bit on a 16-bit system, and for both of those cases, you still keep the overflow, and when you write back 2, it will be shifted into something that fits into an 8-bit integer again. However, on an 8-bit system, this will overflow, wrap around, and produce, 244 instead of 500. And then when we try to divide by 2, we are exactly 128. So you could either try to implement the Misra spec. There are plenty of static analyzers for that. They're all licensed, of course. Misra itself is licensed as well, very expensive. You can try to use those large amount of rules, have code that actually decently tells you to overflow, have a lot of static calls, have a language in which you constantly have to fear that something like that might happen, or you might make the sensible choice and just use a language that does this. Thank you for your attention.
How is it compared to a C language or
embedded systems is about the same. Most of the things that we saw, including the main function, not the main program that we saw at the beginning, compiles to the exact same code as a C program would. On one embedded system, on Linux for example, you also import, aside from the entire C library, you also import the entire Rust library, so your code will automatically be slightly larger. Additionally, you see this thing here? That's generics. They are currently implemented by monomorphization, which might also increase your code size. So that's one thing you do need to be careful about. No other?
Do you know of any, commercial or open source really devices that need this language?
On the systems, not really. It's fairly it's not really major. There are not many people who use it at the moment. It's all still a bit gimmicky until it gets to a bit of a stabilized state. But for Rust itself, there are plenty of projects that actually use it. For example, Firefox uses this as an the renderer. Servo it's called, it's written in Rust directly. There are other projects, mostly open source actually. I'm not really sure about commercial solutions. Most of them are open source just because Rust is a very open source language itself, because the way it's structured. But that would actually bring me to the far diving and so on. So just keep it that.
Have you had any luck
for
promoting this language inside?
Yes. I had a talk about it last week. I tried to we had some kind of a workshop week where we tried to explain how the internals of our project were working. And I got the chance to talk about an hour about how Rust actually works under the hood. Well, treated under the hood, but how it behaves. A very basic intro, basic course actually. They were interested. And if I'm lucky, I already implemented some parts, very small parts, in Rust at my company. So if we're lucky, we're going to see more of that. I think that the core product, the thing that we're actually selling, will stay in C++. A very strict subset of C++, just because you want people who graduated to be able to work on it directly. You don't want to retrain them. I got kind of bad luck with the fact that I'm using very little logic in my code. It's just writing a red blink. Not really very complex to implement. So most of the code was indeed trying to interface with the hardware. Once you get into bigger projects, you can just have very small wrappers, basically just to access your register themselves. And even if you write a UART driver or something, you can do that perfectly in perfectly safe Rust code that just says we need to send impulses and then use unsafe to actually connect that driver with the hardware. Just that if the driver says we have to write a certain number to a certain register, that the unsafe connection actually says, well, that's the register we need to write.
Yeah, you told me to avoid the standard lib. Can't you do the same like in C, just static link instead of dynamically and take the parts you need?
Yeah, you can do that. That's currently what we've done on the embedded system, I think.
Yeah. So that the size increase of the standard lib is minimal?
No, not really, because C does not contain the Rust library. But Rust does contain GDC.
No, just the standard library from Rust, take the parts you need.
It's kind of complicated sometimes to be able to do that properly. Linking is very difficult, apparently. There are still some unsolved problems about that, for example, for generics. At this moment, you're relying on, Rust is relying on monomorphization for that. It's a design choice they made. But other parts of the standard library especially need to be included in any Rust program. For example, all mechanics around actually converting your print line into a decent function, into something that writes to standard libraries, because it's not just same as printf. It actually contains also formatting and so on. So you need to include that because you never know whether your project will need it. If you enable link time optimization, stuff is slightly better.
Okay, thank you, David.